Hey readers, welcome back to Read Through Rune B with me, Rune B. Today we are continuing with our read Gumshoes, The Case of Madison's Father by Russell Nolte. We are on chapter 13, Confronting Otis. Madison popped out of the pile and stumbled up the stairs after Otis. Stewart tried, unsuccessfully, to pull her back. "Where are you going?" he asked. "Where does it look like?" she said. "I'm following that bag." "You're crazy. If that's your father, Otis will kill you too." "Stewart, if that's my dad, there's no way Otis is getting away with this. If I have to stop him myself, my dad's gonna have justice." Madison fumbled her way to the railing and up the staircase. Stewart saw Madison's silhouette push the door open and creeped out. He climbed out of his hiding place and followed her. "Can't we talk about this?" He scurried across the floor and ran up the stairs. Madison screamed with every ounce of her being. The scream not only echoed through the basement door, but also shook the basement. "Stop it!" Stewart burst out the back door. Madison stood at the bottom of the deck across from the unfinished garden. Otis, stunned, dropped the bag. Stewart watched as Madison closed in on Otis and the bag. "I'm not going to let you get away with this." Otis backpedaled into the overgrown shrubbery. "Excuse me, little girl. Were you just in my house?" "That's right, and we saw everything. We know what you did, and you're about to get arrested, and we have all the evidence we need right here." Otis stepped forward, offended by Madison's tone. "Listen here, I don't know what you think I did." As he moved within range, Madison kicked him in the shin and sent Otis reeling to the ground. "I'm not going to be stopped." Otis nursed his sore shin as Madison bent down next to the black bag. She placed her hand on the zipper and closed her eyes. "Dad, I'm sorry we didn't get here sooner." Madison unzipped the bag, eyes still clenched shut. She opened her eyes and gasped in horror. Quickly, those gasps turned into mumbled confusion. She turned to Otis. "What is this? Where's my father?" She charged Otis. Stewart stepped into the spot that she had vacated and knelt down to examine the bag. Over his shoulder, he heard Madison scream, "Where is he? I have no idea what you're talking about," said Otis. "Yes, you do. Sylvester Alberts, my father. Where is he?" "I don't know." "Liar!" Madison punched Otis hard in the stomach. "Where is he?" Otis coughed. "I don't know what you're talking about." Madison grabbed Otis's shoulder and kneed him in the chest. She crumpled on top of him and smacked him repeatedly with all her might. "Tell me, tell me, tell me!" Madison sobbed uncontrollably as Otis tried to push her off, but her fury gave her the strength of 10 men. "I'll kill you," she screamed. Meanwhile, Stewart dug his hand into the bag and pulled out a pair of gardening shears. Confused, he opened the bag. There was no body inside, not even one of a small bowl. Instead, he found gardening implements of every size and shape. He turned and saw Madison wailing on Otis. He rushed over and pulled Madison off. "Madison, stop!" "No, he killed my dad. He did it. I know he did." Madison tried to get in a final flurry of kicks before Stewart pulled her away. Madison struggled and wriggled as hard as she could, but eventually she resigned herself and collapsed into a heap, crying and weeping uncontrollably on the ground. "I'm very sorry about that. Her father is missing, and we thought..." Otis stood and wiped himself off. "You thought what? I kidnapped him and killed him? What could possibly make you think that?" There was a file in her father's office, a red file. You made death threats against him. You work at Thomas Pharmaceuticals, making chloroform, which you used to knock him out." Otis shook his head. "I'll admit that the evidence doesn't show me in a good light. But what you don't know is that we finally agreed to a settlement of my wife's case, and she's getting the treatment she needs."
"You said, what in the where now?" said Stewart. "My wife got very sick while working on a chemical compound for Thomas called J47S. While I continued to work for Thomas, my wife couldn't work anymore. We filed a suit after Thomas refused to consider her claim a job-related injury. Mr. Alberts represented the company. I couldn't believe the company that I had dedicated my life to would just watch my wife wither away. I was angry. Now, I'm ashamed I sent those letters, but what else was I going to do? I had to get through to him somehow. Tears formed in Otis's eyes. She's my life. I can't go on without her. Madison collected herself. You're not helping your case. Let him finish, said Stuart. Thank you, said Otis. Last week, we had a breakthrough. Mr. Alberts called and told me the company had a change of heart. They agreed to settle and pay all of our back medical expenses and give my wife the care she needs. So you see, I love Mr. Alberts. He gave me back my wife. But we heard you talking about your master plan, how it was all coming together. Stuart said, how did you... My wife comes home this weekend after being stuck in hospital for 6 months. She loves nature, but even after coming home, she won't have the energy to do much more than walk outside and enjoy the garden. So I rented a pickup with 100 different types of flowers so she can have something pretty to look at while she recuperates. Wow, I feel foolish, said Stuart. Maybe I should have just asked you, huh? Otis reached into his coat pocket and pulled out a handkerchief. He walked over to Madison and handed it to her. Here, your father is a good man. Madison took the handkerchief and blew her nose. Thank you. I'm sorry about everything. Otis smiled and patted her on the head. I understand more than you know. Thinking someone you love is in trouble tends to make you a little irrational. As Otis and Madison shared a tender moment, Stuart heard the unmistakable sound of police sirens drawing near. Did someone call the police? 5 police cars swarmed the street. Police officers scattered from their cars and took up defensive positions around the home's perimeter as the officers formed rank. Stuart noticed several of Otis's neighbors gathering on their decks with looks of concern on their faces. An elderly woman stared at them from her perch in her bedroom. She held a cordless phone and grinned in silent ambition. Stuart gulped loudly. Oh no, my dad. The East Willow police station was quite small and rustic in comparison to those in the surrounding cities and towns. Patrolmen and officers bumped elbows as they shared a cramped desk space. As a senior-ranking detective, Josiah had managed to secure an office at the furthest corner of the building, away from the hustle and bustle. Madison and Stuart occupied a corner of the bench as they stared at the ground in penance. Madison's arms curled into themselves, and her brow furrowed while Stuart's legs kicked in the wind. Every once in a while, a sigh would break from the silence as they waited for Josiah to return and dole out their punishment. Stuart awkwardly tried to break the silence. So, I can't believe your father is the same detective who's in charge of my father's case. Do you know how much I hate him? I'm sorry. Not to mention, you've been completely wrong about everything. You caused me to beat up an innocent guy. He was trying to do something nice for his wife. I can't believe you. It's not only my... What? It's not your fault? You're saying I'm partially to blame? I can't believe you. You're the expert. I trusted you, and you betrayed me. I don't want to talk about it. Let's just sit here in silence. Okay. Stuart opened his mouth to speak, but thought better of it. He looked down at his feet and consigned to his sorrow. The silence built to a crescendo, just as the door burst open and Josiah stormed in. He threw a thick case file on his desk and paced wildly, unable to contain his fury. I can't believe the two of you. If I read this case file correctly, you snuck into an office building, planted an illegal wiretap, trespassed, broke into someone's home, and assaulted a man who's with a gravely ill spouse. That about sum it up? Madison responded as Stewart sat contrite. Yes, sir. You could be arrested for this. You could go to juvenile hall. Luckily, the man you harassed isn't filing charges. Josiah pointed his bulbous finger at Stewart. You are in a lot of trouble, mister. You've led this poor girl around on some wild goose chase. Withheld evidence on a kidnapping investigation. What were you thinking? Stewart bumbled through a clever excuse before giving up. I wasn't, sir. No, you sure weren't. Josiah finished his tirade. I'm glad you're both okay. Madison, I've already informed your grandmother I will be taking you home. Come on, let's go. Madison stood and hurried out the door with a sullen Stewart following behind her. Watching Madison's rejection of Stewart, Josiah wanted to comfort his son, but did not know how. All he could do was give him a hard shove out the door. Picking up his fedora from the coat rack, he threw on his coat and closed the door behind him. Josiah's unmarked police car had been fitted with every gadget a sleuth could want, from an information hub that tracked criminal records to bulletproof glass that separated him from the criminals in the back seat. Unfortunately for him, those criminals currently happened to be his son and a naive schoolmate. Josiah parked the car and exited the vehicle. Stewart, you wait here while I walk Miss Alberts to her front door. He closed the door. Stewart watched from the back seat as Madison walked past her grandmother into the house. Josiah tipped his fedora and walked back to the car. Once in the driver's seat, Josiah started the car and drove away in silence. He snuck a stern glance through the rear view mirror. Stewart's eyes locked with his father and wondered what horrible punishment he would have to endure, and if there was even an iota of a chance that he would be forgiven for his actions. You know, his father said, I was in middle school once, too. There was a girl, Teresa Williams. Man, I was over the moon for her. Every day I would stand by her locker and try to get a whiff of her hair. One day I gathered up just enough nerve to ask her out. I walked up to her, cleared my throat, but nothing came out. I stood there like an idiot. Everybody pointed and laughed. I was humiliated. Stewart perked up. What happened? I ran away. I never talked to her again. Oh, Stewart responded dejectedly. Great story. My point, son, is that I always regretted it. You know, not trying. Not going the distance to impress her and make her aware of my existence. What I'm trying to say is that you made a fool out of yourself today, but you don't have to quit trying. You see my point, son? No. Stewart glared at his father. Josiah sighed. He was obviously no better at connecting with his son than he was with his wife. He resigned himself to driving in silence while listening to the whisper of the road. And that ends chapter 13 of Gumshoes. Stay safe. Keep reading, be awesome, be excellent, and we'll see you next time. Bye, readers!